they nowhere in their heads feel, even if they won't be winning any trophy, that they have lost something. And this is something which I said yesterday also, that when you moot, you acquire all the necessary skills that you require as a lawyer. Research, advocacy, argumentation, presentation, and everything. So in essence, all of you stand as winners today. We have extremely, extremely distinguished guests with us today. We will introduce them one by one in due course. But I would, to the guests, I would like to say that the teams from all over the country, be the best, we had team participation from everywhere. And
I requested Honorable Chancellor Suneel Galgotia, sir, to present a token of our appreciation to Justice Endlaw for having taken out the time for our event. Thank you, sir. We are deeply indebted. And personally, that will prepare them for a life of citizenship and leadership. The focus on this 360 degree transformation is because we function as an institution that's committed to excellence at all levels. An authority in its true nature, sir, has always been immensely helpful, cooperative, and encouraging for all our endeavors. We are obliged to be able to work under someone of your stature and vigor. I request you, sir, to please grace the dais and say a few words. Please, sir.
Honorable Mr. Justice Rajiv Sahai, Endlaw, Justice High Court of Delhi. Honorable Mr. G.R. Raghavender, Joint Secretary, Department of Justice, Ministry of Law. I am truly honored and privileged to the eminent and distinguished guests for accepting our invitation and sacrificing this Saturday evening to be present here today at the valedictory function at the first National Moot Court Competition 2018. It was flagged off by the Honorable Chief Justice of India. The legal profession is one of the most competitive professions in the world. To make a mark in this profession and to achieve the status of the legal legion, or to be known as a wizard of law, one needs to nurture and develop a great stamina to argue, require captivating skills, astute activeness, and give innovative interpretations with legal logic. And all this can be achieved by perseverance, hard work, and self-sacrifice. I believe once you dedicate yourself and condition your mind towards learning, you will become a champion of law and will be able to give creative and original arguments which are sought after in the court of law. I firmly believe events such as this one will equip you with the knowledge and skills gained from people of such high caliber and expertise, which will help you face the challenges of the real world. I thank all the students, faculty, and entire team for organizing this event. I wish all the participants present here from across the country had a great learning and experience. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your words of wisdom. Your vision is our mission. Experience, determination, intelligence, creativity, open-mindedness, enthusiasm, and encouragement are a few from the plethora of qualities that our esteemed Vice Chancellor Renu Luthra ma'am possesses. I have been awestruck every time I have had the opportunity to be an audience to your words of wisdom and intellect, a support system, and an occasional hard hand when needed. Renu ma'am has always been more than supportive for each and every event that the School of Law has organized. Excellence breeds excellence, and with a leader like you, we sure are bound to go a long way. Ma'am, if I could please request you to oblige us by addressing the August gathering. Please, ma'am.
our distinguished chief guest on the occasion, Mr. G.R. Raghavender, Joint Secretary, Department of Law, Ministry of Law and Justice, Government of India. Our presiding guest, His Lordship, Honorable Justice Mr. Rajiv Sahai, Endlaw, Judge High Court of India. Mr. Galgotia, Chancellor Galgotia University, Mr. Dhruv Galgotia, CEO Galgotia University, Professor Kiran, Dean School of Law, my faculty colleagues, Dr. Sheetal, and my dear young mooters, if I can call you that. A very good afternoon to you, and a very warm welcome to the valedictory function. It's my pleasure to welcome such distinguished guests as we have with us today. These are personas who have, with their sterling performance, increased or taken the reputation of the judiciary, the credibility of the judiciary to great heights. Thank you, sirs. Thank you ever so much for sparing time out of your busy schedule to give us this rare privilege to listen to your insights and, of course, to give blessings to all these young competitors who are assembled here today. At Galgotia University, we are incessantly striving to ensure holistic education for the young men and women who trust us with their future. Experiential learning, project-based learning, research-based learning are some of the tools which are emphasized in every school of the university, and the moot court competition and the numerous moot courts organized by the School of Law are an effort in that direction. My dear students, since yesterday you've been arguing your cases for the application of law vociferously and making your submissions, my dear students, this is the closest you ever get during your student life to a simulated courtroom situation. I was once told by, can you hear me? I was once told by a lawyer of a Supreme Court, and this he told me about mooting, and this I'm talking to you of a practicing lawyer. He said, I try to do two moot courts for every Supreme Court case that I handle to ensure that I'm mooted by people who know the Supreme Court well. I cannot imagine walking into the court without the preparation of a few vicious moot courts. It is critical to my thinking. My dear students, what a lesson that you must have learned today is that you do not need cheerleaders who encourage you with, you know, good words of praise. You need these mooters who have a different point of view. My dear participants, today you must have overcome your inhibitions and presented your case in the boldest possible manner. What would have been your takeaways that will stand you in good stead throughout your legal career? Oratory skills for one, formal legal writing and drafting, research and analytical skills, teamwork and coordination, to name a few. My dear students, and the participants who've come across India, congratulations. For me, each of you is a winner who stood there on stage, mooted his cause, mooted his interpretation of the laws. Irrespective of who goes with the trophy, you are richer, richer by the experience, richer by the knowledge, and of course, richest by being in the presence of the galaxy of amazing speakers, our chief guest, His Lordship, Justice Sahai, Mr. Raghavender. These are the two persons who are going to touch your life today and leave such a memorable impact and imprint in your lives that I know will guide you and bless you in your journey. Congratulations, School of Law, for organizing and putting this event together. I cannot name each of the organizers. each of the faculty, each of the student volunteers, but I have been witness the meticulous planning, the detailed planning that took place in the school. So thank you very much and congratulations once again. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I assure you, we are blessed and bound by your words in the very essence of it. We also have with us today our Gen Y Ambassador, Mr. Dhruv Galgotia, sir, the esteemed CEO of Galgotias University. With a knack for projecting pragmatism with idealism into work, Dhruv, sir, has fast-tracked the growth trajectory at Galgotia. Committed to international education in India, his focus is on collaborative global education system for a greater impetus to academic excellence at Galgotias. His success mantra is to dream big and to focus on achieving that dream. And with the same ideology, he has been instrumental in making Galgotias a center for absolute and overall development and success. His charisma and energy is infectious, and it is an absolute delight to be able to hear and imbibe the words of someone of his demeanor. Thank you, sir, for being here with us today. Though the teams have known her since yesterday, I would still consider it a privilege to introduce to all of you my former professor and present boss, the Dean's School of Law, Professor Dr. Kiran Gardner, Galgotias University. Each and every event that has been promulgated has been your brainchild, ma'am. A leader without any concept of time or comfort, you make us strive harder and harder towards success and victory. Thank you, ma'am, for your constant support and impeccable leadership on behalf of all the faculties and the students.
Ma'am said that we have a galaxy of guests with us, and perhaps two of the distinguished guests who were the best choice for being in this valedictory session. First of all, I would like to introduce Mr. Raghavender, sir. He is a civil servant from Central Secretariat Service, 1988. At present, he is the Joint Secretary, Department of Justice, Ministry of Law and Justice since January 2017. He is also the Mission Director for the National Mission for Justice Delivery and Legal Reforms. He is currently driving policy reforms for improving enforcing contracts parameter under the Ease of Doing Business and E-Courts project. Earlier, he was the Joint Secretary in Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, Ministry of Commerce and Industry. There, he had an additional charge of Director General, National Productivity Council. He is also perhaps the main reason why he's between us today. He was also the Registrar of Copyrights in the Indian Copyrights Office. He played a key role in production of the recent amendments in the Copyright Act 2012 and Copyright Rules 2013. He attended many WIPO meetings and FTA negotiations. He made significant contributions to recently concluded two WIPO treaties. One is the Beijing Treaty on Audiovisual Performances, and the another one is the Marrakech Treaty for the Visually Impaired People. That treaty has ensured that visually impaired people have a free access to the copyrighted materials, something which is extremely, extremely critical for the visually impaired people to have an access to. He has also contributed in revision of the copyright legislations of Bhutan and Myanmar as an expert. As a resource person, he gives lectures and talks on copyrights and related issues in various universities and WIPO forums and other international forums as well. He is also the chief guest for today. I would request Mr. G.R. Raghavender to address the gathering.
Honorable Justice Rajiv and Laji, Delhi High Court, and Honorable Suneel Galgotia, the Chancellor, and Mr. Dhruv, CEO, Dr. Luthra, the Vice Chancellor, and Kiranji, the Dean, and my end friends and my colleague judges from the Moot Court, Renu ji and Mr. Ashutosh. Good evening to all. I'm very honored to be here among the company, sharing this stage with Honorable Justice, and also member of the Moot Court Final Committee. As a student of law, I never got the time to attend the Moot Court, even though I wanted to, because I was attending the office in the daytime and attending the law college evening in the LC1 Delhi University. But I got trained in the legal field by young advocates like you and experts like Amarjit Singh Ji and now Justice Pratibha Singh, who was a senior advocate at the time. So these people who used to come with a lot of research and the various cases placed before me about the registration. So then they inspired me to do law, and then I went and got admission and became student like you. And then I went on doing and updating my knowledge. And then, you know, it is the Moot Court research, the lawyer's research inspired me to do a lot of research and then expand that my research and get more knowledge through the stakeholder discussions. I mean, consulting various young lawyers, whether it was during the amendment to the Copyright Act 2012, or drafting the rules 2013, or becoming the chief negotiator for the two treaties, Beijing Treaty and Marrakesh Treaty. Nice. Everywhere it is the lawyers and the professors who teach copyright law, and lawyers who practice the copyright law who enlighten me. And without that, you know, whatever I have achieved in my career, contributed in my career would have not been possible. And today I have seen young students. I congratulate all the 20 teams participated here, and especially the two teams who come to the final, done excellent job, and the kind of research I have done, and then, you know, really learning experience for us also, and it should go on. Now the topic of intellectual property rights, and especially the copyright, in the online digital environment has become again a lot of importance. You must be reading various judgments, past, and then the importance of public interest, which was flagged by the both teams today, is very, very important. It has been recognized in the TRIPS, Article 7 and Article 8 especially, and also the entire length and breadth of the preambles of the new internet treaties like the WIPO treaty, like Copyright Treaty, Performance Phonograms Treaty, Beijing Treaty, and then human rights aspect to the public interest are also considered. But one should respect the balancing the rights of the right owners and then the public interest, which you are aware and you argued in the both groups have argued pretty well, and this balancing the rights and public interest and right owner's interest. So this is what the knowledge you have collected and then try to communicate to us. So I appreciate this and wish you all the best. As Madam Luthra said, it's not a question of winning and taking the trophy and contributing and then enlightening the various others to gather here about the various aspects and parameters of the law. That's very, very important. And in the law ministry, we are contributing to the better systems to be provided, whether it is automation of the courts, filling up of the vacancies, various steps we are taking. Of course, we do get a lot of guidance from the Justice Madan Loku, who heads the E-Committee or NCMS, which I am a member the Vice Chancellor of ex-Vice Chancellor Mohan Gopal, Dr. Mohan Gopal, and the team of senior judges who sit there. And really, their knowledge is very interesting. The kind of contributions they make, what is their experience, and a policy making. We learn a lot from advocates and judges, then only we are able to implement a few good things in the ministry, whether it is launching of NAVICAS portal for the better monitoring of the infrastructure projects, or awarding the BSNL to improve the bandwidth from 2 Mbps to 10 Mbps and connect all 547 no connectivity codes in India to make them, you know, digital. So various steps we do with the help of judiciary and also the feedback given to us by the advocates. And once again, congratulate all the teams. And I would like to thank the management of the Galgotia University and especially Kiran ji and Dr. Umar for inviting me and giving me opportunity. Thank you.
All right, so this is perhaps my favorite part of the program. And because I'm getting the opportunity of introducing someone whom we all collectively admire, we read his judgments and get inspired from them. I would like to introduce Justice Rajiv Sahai, Endlaw, who is the current judge of the High Court of Delhi, and he is the presiding guest for our event today. He was born in Delhi and he did his schooling from Delhi Public School, Mathura, and he did his law graduation from Campus Law Center, Delhi University. And then initially he joined a solicitor's firm for 3 years, and thereafter he practiced in different areas like real estate, family, film, and
judges who judge the moot court, they are the judges for the day actually. I am a judge from Monday to Friday. The Chancellor, Mr. Galgotia, the faculty members and friends. This is my first visit to this university, and I always thought that Galgotia University is what one sees from Parichop. But I have been greatly enlightened today. In fact, the students who come to High Court to guide me there, I made them wait for half an hour. I thought that it will just take me about 40 minutes to Parichop. I didn't realize that one had to come here. And it's really been an eye-opener. I think all the students and the faculty who are here, it's an ideal environment to be in universities. So much greenery anywhere in Delhi, except perhaps in the Latian's part of Delhi, and which has a handful of residents. So make the best use of it, and my congratulations to Mr. Galgotia for this vision. I think it's been an amazing achievement for the field of education, and this is something which will be there for ages. Judgments are always overruled. But a university campus can't be overrun. So you've created something. So thanks a lot on that. See, I have a favorite subject which I invariably lapse into whenever I have a captive audience of students and faculty member. I'm very glad today that there is so much of faculty here. I have completed 36 years in the field of law. So I think after about 8 years in the profession, I have always been having a large number of youngsters in my chamber. Now as a judge, we get assistance of three law researchers, but a lot of other students are also willing to work as interns or even for free after completing their law. So invariably one has about 8 to 10 people in the chamber at any given point of time. And in my work I rely very heavily on them. So I'll just share with you my thoughts, particularly with the faculty members, of what I felt can be done more for really preparing the law students. And I think it's very important for the law students to participate in that and to help faculty guide them in that direction. One thing which I have been noticing is that law is always the first thing which I'll say. I'll just put three or four points before you that the legal profession is being treated more and more as something to do with speaking. So the whole emphasis is on that how well you speak, how well you are prepared to speak. But what we forget is that when you are practicing as a lawyer in whatever field, we have a very misguided term nowadays, corporate. Corporate is no different from corporate is that all right, some of us would not be going to the court. A better term is non-litigation. The laws are the same whether it's corporate or it's two individuals. And when the corporates also come to courts, the same laws apply to them. So corporate is a misnomer. The better term is non-litigation. That is something which you do sitting in the court or in the chamber. But even while sitting in the chamber, unless you know that which way the wind is blowing, which way the judgments are going, you cannot render proper advice. So you have to have a connect. So that's why I said that what I am saying applies to all fields of law, not only to people who are going to be litigators, that the speaking part of the profession comes only after you listen. And I think all of us are lacking in listening. All moot courts also are designed to, you know, speak and after reading. So what I have a suggestion for all of you to consider, and if you find it feasible, I'm not an academic, I have no experience of teaching, that maybe there can be moot courts where the participants have just been told verbally the problem. And then the important thing will be to see how much you absorb through the ears. We have all got used to absorbing through our eyes and other senses, but we are not absorbing through the ears. And when the client comes to you or the person you are working with, the senior lawyer or the judge, when they tell you something to do, you miss out because you are just not used to speaking. So if you have not listened and if you have not understood, you cannot possibly deliver what is asked from you. So there has to be some, please try to start concentrating on your listening senses, that how much you absorb through your ears and how much you analyze on that. So that was the first thing which I wanted to put for consideration. The second was that the entire emphasis again is on what is law. But law is such a vast subject that nobody can possibly know what is law. A good lawyer has always been defined as a person who knows where to find law. So your training skills have to be honed towards being able to find law, being able to pick up the books or the bare acts of applying to the situation, just to recognize that, all right, what the problem is, where can I possibly find the law for it? And over a period of time, that skill develops. So, but that I find is lacking in most of the youngsters. You know, most of them are brilliant. Once you give them the task in the morning, they'll do it beautifully, much better than any of us can do it. But if one morning you are in a rush and you don't tell them what to do that day, they are totally at a loss. Till lunchtime, they'll be sitting without knowing what is to be done. For instance, they are unable to pick up the practice I follow. Everybody follows a different practice, is that when I dictate the judgments, a lot of times I keep on putting a question mark. There only I'll say, check up case law on this proposition, check up whether there are any contrary law. But if I miss out on any day or in any part of the judgment to write that, the law researchers are unable to pick up that, all right, this is a proposition of law on which work is required to be done. So you have to train yourself to be able to find law rather than know law. Don't concentrate on knowing law. Once you know how to find law, you will be able to find any law which you may be faced with for whatsoever problem. And in that context, only the related thing is, I don't know, I'll request the teachers if they can guide. I have seen 4 or 5, there are videos on the YouTube on this, but none of them very satisfactory, that how to learn. See, none of us know how to learn, and I realized this for the first time when we used to keep on telling our son, learn this, learn that, when he was 5 years old. And one day he said that, Baba, ye to batate nahi ho ke how to learn. And that's the day I realized, and ever since then I have been keeping a watch on the net whenever a new video comes on this, that how to learn. There are some lessons which are useful but not perfect. But all of you with so much host of experience in teaching and in dealing with youngsters perhaps will be able to more, because that is allied to how to find law. That they are not able to retain. What I find is that, as I said, that you don't give them the task one day and they are totally blind. They will, even an identical problem, they will not be able to know. They are not able to know that, all right, what am I expected to do today? That, all right, I have done this in this situation, I can put that experience to use in another situation. So that connect has to be formed in the mind of where all a particular experience can be used. So how to learn is a very important part, and I think there are some textbooks also on that. There is one Indian author, and I think Kahneman has written a very good book on learning, that how the learning learning can be learned, that how to learn. So please, and nowadays we don't need to read books. There is so much material available on the net. I'm sure even Kahneman would be available on the net. So pay some attention towards that. Then another thing which again is allied is that there is a lot of confidence. See, all colleges are boosting your confidence, but that confidence has one misdirection, and that misdirection is that you start hesitating to ask questions, and which is a big lacuna. If you don't ask questions at this age, you will never be able to learn. You will, when you come into the working life, you will never be able to. So it's very important to ask questions, and I'll tell you why asking questions is also important, not only for learning from your senior or learning from the place where you are training, but also from the point of view of a client comes to you with a problem. See, when you are senior in the profession, you will maybe have a ready-made brief and you will prepare from that. But as a beginner in the profession, you will be doing cases of clients who may be perhaps not well-paying and who will come and tell you their problem. Now, he doesn't know that which is the relevant fact for it. He'll tell you only the things which he or she feels are relevant. So unless you ask questions, I'm finding that in a lot of pleadings which are being filed in the court, that when you start quizzing the client present in the court, there are facts which come out which were so relevant for their decision of the case and which are not pleaded by the lawyer who has drafted. So only if you ask, you don't hesitate in asking the client. Don't think that in front of the client, if you pull out a book or pull out a bare act, he'll feel you don't know law. In fact, my experience is that the clients feel more encouraged, they get more confidence in you that this lawyer is taking pains to study again for our case and find out what the law is. So wherever you are, and you have to start that in the classes right now, I don't know how many of you ask questions in the classes, but that is the only way, you know, your teachers also grow in the profession. We used to have one professor, Sivaramaya, he used to teach Hindu law in campus law center, and he used to encourage questions a lot. And I asked him one question in the class, and very frankly he said, I have never examined it, I thought it was all forgotten. After 1 month, he called me and he told me that this is the that was a question regarding the Hindu succession act. So look at the brilliance of the person, that for 1 month he was working on it. I didn't even know. In fact, I had half forgotten. It was just off the cuff question in the class which I had asked. So start practicing that now. Only once you start practicing that now will you be able to ask questions to your client, ask questions to your senior or whosoever you are working with, and which will go a long way in building you up as a better lawyer, as a better professional at any point of time. One big thing which is happening in the legal profession and which I must share with you, I don't think, again, whichever law colleges I have gone off till now, I have not had a chance to discuss with the Chancellor also on this aspect, is that the so-called corporate lawyer will be disappearing. I don't know whether you people have been reading. There are a lot of brilliant softwares which are available in the US courts and which give you an exact okay of cases listed before this judge. Before this judge, you have to cite these judgments. This is the likely result of it. So there is the predictive software is taking over all the, see the corporate work largely till now was due diligence. So the Chancellor was also mentioning that the lawyers spend so many long hours in the office. Now part of that long hours, sir, is that when a transaction comes and you have to do due diligence for the last 12 years of all the books of the company being taken over, that time it takes a hell out of, but all that work is now happening. There are readers which are available in the market. In India, we are not getting it the cost. In fact, we were thinking of installing the this what they have in the US courts, that they record evidence verbatim. But we were told that the cost per court would be about a crore of rupees. So we've shelved that at the moment. So, but very soon one, I'm sure somebody will produce a cheaper machine and everything will be recorded. Now the Supreme Court has permitted, all of you must have read, has permitted live streaming of the court cases. So your performance is going to be seen by your client. It won't make a difference that you can take a date and the client doesn't know, you can bill the client. Now the client will be able to see what you did in the court. So you have to be, yeah, so coming back to this software, the artificial intelligence is coming in a big way. It is going to reduce the requirement for lawyers in the law firms. Today we have large law firms which have 200 people, 300 people. But perhaps we will not be, the research is becoming easier by the day. What 8 or 10 people are doing today for me researching for case law. If the artificial intelligence software is there, maybe I don't need 8 or 10 people. So what will happen to all of you? But it's not that gloomy. There is a lot of research on this also, and they say that there are special human qualities which you have to learn, which you have to develop, so that you can be productive along with the artificial intelligence. For instance, artificial intelligence doesn't have a heart till now. Artificial intelligence is not so receptive about the human behavior. So as a lawyer, you have to learn those skills so that what artificial intelligence cannot do, that perhaps you will be able to contribute and you will remain useful to any client and the client will not discard you. Naturally, in the US it has started happening that if you can get the outcome of a case in $100, why would you pay any lawyer for years to win a case? You will know that all right, the outcome is going to be lost. So I might as well not fight about that case. One other thing which I won't say I have noticed in all, but I would say about 50% of the people don't feel the, I'm talking of the youngsters, don't feel the pain of the client. See, a very senior lawyer had told me when I had joined the profession, I happened to ask him, I was doing a long trial with him in Bangalore, and he was reading when I went to his room. So I said, okay, sir, you still have to for cross-examination read till the last moment. And he said, Rajiv, the day I stop getting butterflies before in my stomach, before going to the court, I'll die as a lawyer. So it's very important to have those butterflies in your stomach before you go for representing. See, he has trusted you with his, the client has trusted you with his property, life, and you may think that all right, it's a case worth 1 lakh of rupees, but for him that 1 lakh of rupees is all that he has. So no case is small or big. Once you have taken up a case, once you have taken up an assignment, it's as important as any other assignment, and you have to feel that where the shoe pinches. So once you have that, I think that will automatically impel you to do your best, and which is what is expected, because after all you have taken money from him to buy his problems. So once you have taken money, it's a position of trust. Whether he sues you for breach of trust or not, but in your mind you will know that all right, if you've not done your best, or what could have been done for the client, that is a breach of trust or a cheating. So don't take up the case if you feel you can't do for it, but once you take it up, do the best for the client. I'm sorry, I think I've taken longer than I expected, but as I said in the beginning, that it's very rarely that one gets a captive audience. In the court, we are always being questioned by the lawyers. Thank you so much.
You are a teacher for all of us. So now we come to the big moment, right? And for which all of us have been waiting, all of us are tired. And so we start with the Best Memorial Award for first paperless Galgotia University National Network Competition. And I would request Honorable Chancellor Sir to announce the results for the Best Memorial.
The Best Memorial goes to Sastra University.
And we request Sastra University to come out of the board and take the award from Honorable Justice Rajiv, Sahai, Endlaw. Congratulations, team. Now we have the next award for best speaker in the entire round, and I will request Mr. G.R. Raghavender to do the honors.
Best speaker is Deeksha Joshi.
Very well done. Now the big moment, of course.
And I would request Justice Rajiv Sahai Endlaw to do the honors and announce the winner of the competition. And of course, then we will be knowing the winners as well. Sir, so if you may please.
The big one, Sastra University.
A huge round of applause for the winner of this competition, Sastra University from Tamil Nadu. Very, very well deserved and very well done.
In the same stride, not any lesser winner, the runner-up.
Oh, what an honor! Receive it. Receive the class.
The runners-up, I would request the Symbiosis Law School Pune to come up and collect their trophies. Very well done and very well proud of them. A huge round of applause for the runners-up out here. Congratulations to both the winners and congratulations to all the winners as well. Now I would give the mic to my esteemed colleague, Ms. Sastra University, to take proceedings for that.
Congratulations to the winners. We are immensely grateful for the time that you have bestowed upon us, honorable guests, and in no way can we even dream of being able to repay it. Nonetheless, please allow us to express our heartfelt gratitude in the form of a memento, which if nothing else, would be a memory to be cherished for a lifetime. Honorable Chancellor sir, and respected CEO sir, could you please extend the mementos to Honorable Justice of Delhi High Court, Mr. Rajiv Sahai Endlaw. Thank you so much, sir. Now, I would like to call upon Dean Ma'am to please grace the podium and profess the word of thanks.
I know. When it's time to say vote of thanks, we look forward, okay, the program is coming to an end, right? It has been an immense pleasure to have Honorable Justice Rajiv Sahai Endlaw to be here and Mr. Raghavender GR, the Joint Secretary Ministry of Law and Justice. It's time to say thank you, and I really resonate with what Umar said, that it was a humbling experience for us to invite them, and they readily accepted our invitations and they are here. I also would like to thank Mr. Galgotia. Every time when I say that, he said, there's no need, I'm a person at home, why do you have to thank us? But let me tell you that from the time I've joined, and for any program or any event when we have approached, it has been no for anything. And like, you know, even when I have put up a paper and said we want to do, he has not even looked at the papers and have signed. And I thank you for all your support. And similarly, I would also say that we've got into technology, just messages, and like if I've put up a WhatsApp message also, I have got a response, and like, you know, said that these things have, we need your help. It's gone out of the way to facilitate, and I always say young and dynamic CEO that we have, whether, I really don't know whether he's in India or whether he's abroad, but he has seen to it that whatever we request, we have asked for, we've got. I thank you a lot from bottom of my heart for being there always. It has been, it has not been very long that I have been here, but I would really say that Dr. Luthra has always been there, and like I have walked in her office, there are times when she would say, not now, not go later on, and then when I have been going, and like she's gone all out to help, to support, and to take the things further. There's no words that I could say thanks to her. This event, I would also say that wherever I asked for help, the deans, the the nursing deans, or whatever we wanted, we just said, "Ma'am, ye chahiye," and we just got a helping hand. And I should say that every pro vice chancellor, every dean, whenever I approach them, they said, "Kuch chahiye, kuch help hai, to keh dena." And it's really in true sense the feeling of family that you get over here. I also would like to thank all the judges who came for preliminary round, who came for semi-final round, who came for final round. Final round judges are here with us. And I would say it was just, they were just a call away. In Delhi, to go to one end and the other end, it's a bit difficult. But everyone said, you don't need to come, we'll be there. And another humbling experience that I had when we were organizing the Moot, that none of the judges said, kya aap lene aao, aap chhodne aao, aap ye karo. Like it was so very wonderful, where I saw people wanted to give back to the society. When I met judges, we get to meet the students, we get to give back to the society. So this time, for the semi-final and final round, we had all the senior associates and partners from the law firm. And let me tell you that, I never thought it was so very easy to get them all over here. And they just said yes, and they just came. And I'm so very thankful to each one of you for coming here and judging by you. I know things cannot go further without my team, and I would say day and night my faculties and students and volunteers have really worked to make this program a success. And I'm sure all those who are here from all different corners of the country, I hope you had a good time over here, good learning, and good, you made new friends. And I hope you will go back with good memories of this place, and we will remain in touch, right?
Yes.
one thing that I would like to say, that we had limited this to 24 teams. And these 24 teams, like when we put it out, put it open, and we had said it would be first come, first serve basis. And we had teams from 12 different states coming here. So we had team from Assam, we had team from Tamil Nadu, we had team from Maharashtra, from MP, from Uttarakhand, from Punjab, from Haryana, from Rajasthan, and from all over. So I think it was a good, cultural exchange as well, where we came to know people from all over the country. I think special thanks need to go to all my volunteers. You've really done a good job, and I hope we will be able to do this. Thanks a lot. If I have forgotten anyone, it's not that I wanted to leave out, but maybe I'm turning old and may have forgotten somebody. So please excuse me and have a good day. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The event couldn't have been complete without your words of wisdom. Now, if I may please request VC ma'am, Chancellor sir, Dhruv sir, and our esteemed guest to please present a memento of appreciation to Dean ma'am and Nizam sir, as well as Umar sir, because they've been the backbone of this event, and the program cannot come to an end without appreciating them in the true sense. Please. Let's have a big round of applause, guys. Please, you guys are very loud. I would request everyone to rise for the national anthem.
Janakana mana adhinayaka jayahe Bharat bhagya vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Uttara Vanda तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता